Good morning. Hey guys, welcome. Thanks for tuning in on live stream this morning. So it's December. That means we are officially in the clear. It's okay to start talking about Christmas. A few applause back there. Hey guys, it's a privilege to be here this morning, and I am so excited for this series that we've got going this Christmas year. It's exciting. I can't wait to get into it, but before we do, I want you to take a look at the screen and tell me if this is how you feel about Christmas. So is that you?
No.
Is that how you feel about Christmas? I'm not sure if that was excitement or possession. Maybe you've got a different perspective. Maybe Christmas is a sadder time for you. Maybe your heart hurts a little bit. That's kind of where the culture's at right now. Well, this series is going to challenge some of us that is exactly how we should feel at this time of year. And don't get wound up. Don't call me some materialistic driven hypocrite. Hear me out. If you're looking forward to this time of year for the cool gifts, the twinkling lights, the festive decorations like we have around here, thanks to Leslie for putting that together this week. If that's what you're getting excited about, it's great, but you're missing out. This holiday is about everybody being nice to the people that otherwise get ignored. It's just a time for family to get together. Nothing wrong with that, but you're setting yourself up for some disappointment. And if you look at Christmas and say, well, it's all about the baby Jesus born in a manger, well, you're getting closer, but you're still selling it short of the real gift. Because this time of year, it celebrates something so much deeper, and there's so much more weight to it than what we, I think, realize. And we're calling this series, this Christmas series, we're calling it The Line. Why? Because Christmas is defined by a line. The arrival of Jesus, this holiday we celebrate, it's a clear break in history. Literally, believer or not, the reality is everything changed when Jesus arrived. Ask any atheist, hey, what year is it? It's 2018 AD. AD is in Anno Domini, Latin for the year of the Lord. So an atheist is going to tell you today is December 2nd, 2018. It's been 2018 years since the Lord Jesus took his first breath. And if there's someone who thinks that believes in old earth and believes in 300,000 BC, there was a Neanderthal man, they're still saying literally 300,000 years before Jesus the Christ was born, they believe there was a Neanderthal man walking. Literally, Jesus is the line by which we've defined time. And it's not just that a baby was born. We're talking about a baby taking his first breath. It's not just a baby. It's the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Savior of the world's arrived. When Jesus arrives, when he is born, it's a starting line, it's a finishing line. Because for the Jews, their anticipation, their wait for the long-awaited Savior, after 400 years of silence, it's finished. The restoration of people from their fallen, sinful state, separated from God, it started with the babe's first cry. Start line, finish line. That's where we're at today. Today we're talking about hope. God's chosen people were holding on to hope, waiting for the Messiah. And that comfort, literally the comforter, It holds us today as that hope is realized with the long-awaited Savior's arrival. For centuries and centuries, the people of Israel, the Jewish people, they were waiting, watching, anticipating the Messiah. It's the one they were counting on that was to deliver them out of all their troubles. And the scriptures of the Old Testament, the prophets, many of them speaking over and over of God's promises that he was sending a deliverer. He was giving them hope for centuries. That's what we're talking about today, that hope. We're going to be looking today at just one of the samples, just one passage of the hope God gave to the people through his prophets. And today we'll be looking at a promise out of Jeremiah. And this promise came during what was really a very difficult time for Israel. Because God's people, they'd been acting like anything but. They'd broken their covenant with God. They were disobeying every command he'd given them, worshiping false gods. They were worshiping idols. And to be very honest, they were doing so in some pretty violent and immoral ways. And so God calls on Jeremiah, calls him into the prophecy, calls him to caution Israel, there's going to be consequences if my people do not return to me and repent. And so Jeremiah warns Israel. He says, guys, look, if we don't straighten up, if we don't fly right, God said there's another nation that's going to swoop in, overthrow us, destroy Jerusalem. We're going to be marched off out of here. And God knew his people. Knew them better than they knew themselves, probably. He knew they were not likely to obey without consequence. It would take drastic measures to pull them out of that downward spiral. So, Babylon comes in. Babylon defeats Israel, destroys the city of Jerusalem, and the Jewish people are marched off to Babylon for what would be 70 years of captivity, of exile. Just as Jeremiah predicted, just as God predicted through his prophet. But we have a God of love. We have a God of second, third, and fourth chances. So God also tells Jeremiah, give them hope. The mess they're in, the mess they created will not last forever. I have a plan to make things right again after the timeout is over. It's a long time out in the corner for them. I just don't think they quite understood how big picture their God was thinking. We'll see what we mean today. Now, there's a verse in Jeremiah that gets quoted a lot. You may have heard it before. There's a good chance some of you have. The verse says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Well, Mark spoke last week in the first service with a full message, and you saw it online. He spoke about there being a backstory. Everything's got a backstory. As in reference to the baptism, well, the backstory to this verse, the backstory to this hope was that the word of hope came as the Israelites are facing these 70 years of captivity. They had to endure this bondage because they had sinned, because of their sin. But even then, God had already drawn a line in the sand of time. And he'd already said that he would send a deliverer. The Savior was on the way. Package ETA, Christmas Day. It's at this point, as Israel's in the captivity, they needed hope. We all need hope, right? I mean, there are times we find ourselves in captivity to sin. There are times we've dug ourselves into a hole, and we're looking for that hope, just like Israel was. In their captivity, the people of Israel had begun to understand that Jeremiah's words were right. They were true. God had warned them this would happen if they continued in their sin, and they did, and here they were. But here's the thing, believe it or not, that's actually good news. That was a good thing for the Israelites at this point. How? Their captivity offered hope. Because if Jeremiah was right about the consequences, then that meant all the words of hope he spoke would also be true. So the Israelites were able to get some confidence that there was a restoration coming. They had God's assurance through Jeremiah that things would get better. They held on to that. But here's where things get a little tricky. What were they actually hoping for? And what was God actually promising? I think we all kind of get tripped up over this question. We look for one thing and God's promising something a little different. So let's look at this passage. We're talking about Jeremiah and the hope that he's given them. Let's look at one of these words of hope Jeremiah gave. We're in chapter 23 of Jeremiah. It says, in verse 3, this is God speaking through Jeremiah. And God says, I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I've driven them. I will bring them back to their pasture where they will be fruitful and increase in number. I will place shepherds over them who will tend them. They will no longer be afraid nor terrified, nor will any be missing, declares the Lord. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely, do what is just and right in the land. And in his day, Judah will be saved and Israel will live in safety. This is the name by which he will be called, the Lord, our righteous Savior. That promise is so important. Jeremiah knew when God spoke it, he meant business. He knew there was something important about it. So important, 10 chapters later, Jeremiah comes back again, and he opens in verse 14, chapter 33, verse 14. He says, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the good promise I made to the people of Israel. I'm going to fulfill the promise I just gave them, we just read, because he repeats it almost word for word. 10 chapters later, almost word for word, he repeats the whole promise, but then he adds something at the end. It's so important. He says, David will never fail to have a man sit on the throne of Israel. That word never implies eternity. It's God saying, I'm talking about something eternal. I think the Israelites were looking for the temporal, because they were grasping for hope. They wanted immediate answers. The people of Israel were kind of like that favorite child. They were gotten spoiled, used to getting their way. They were used to immediate answers. They were used to God delivering them out of their messes kind of quick. They were expecting quick answers. They were at least normally saw things get turned around within their lifetime. But things weren't always going to be that way. I remember we said 70 years of exile. Unless they were little kids, that meant most of the people that left in exile never saw the deliverance in their lifetime. And God told them this was coming. All we got to do is go to Isaiah, who is one of Jeremiah's predecessors as a prophet. Jeremiah says in chapter 43, he says, this is what the Lord says, forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. I'm doing a new thing. It springs up now. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the wilderness. He said, forget the former things. The new wave is coming. It's about to change. I'm operating differently. Because the Israelites, they're looking at the promise that we read in chapter 23, that God was assuring them he was going to bring them out of Babylon. They're hearing this promise that they would go back to Israel and God would protect them and there'd be a king just like David, and that king was going to protect them. That's what they were seeing and hoping for. Well, they did come out of the captivity in Babylon, but it took 70 years. And when they got back to Jerusalem after 70 years, things weren't all well and good. There's a lot of work to be done. I think God was starting to stretch the time frame on their expectations. Me personally. Like Isaiah said, he was doing things differently. He was starting to stretch that, look, I'm starting to work big picture. And we've got a benefit. We can look back through the Bible, through the scriptures, and we can see the big picture of God starting to work out. But we still fall victim to this also. We look for the immediate. We pray and we expect immediate answers. And then when we don't get what we want, we don't get the gift we hope for, the diagnosis we hope for, the exam grade is not what we expect, we don't get the date we were expecting, we're people. Imperfect, we want to fall apart. But see, here's the truth. God's still God. Jesus is still the line by which we measure, and the long term matters more than the short term. Now, for those of you that are sitting here that have been a Christian for a few years and you've walked this, I've read these verses in Jeremiah 23, and you're getting excited. You're seeing something bigger picture already. If you're new to this walk, if you're checking the church out today, I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. I want to let you know why this is so exciting, why we get so excited, why it's run down the stairs screaming and yelling and falling on the floor exciting, because this is what Christmas is. This is where it hits. So we'll take a moment, and we'll go through this passage. I want to help draw the big picture that Jeremiah had in mind where God was speaking. And we could spend hours chasing down these scriptures and digging in and find what they mean. But in the interest of time, And let's be honest, in the interest of keeping some of you awake, we're only going to hit the highlights. We're going to hit the highlights this morning. Don't bother trying to write down these. There's going to be a lot of scripture coming at you. In your program is an insert. All of them are written out there. It's a little chart. You can go back and dig into it later this week. Just ride with me here on these highlights. The passage in chapter 23 speaks of the coming Messiah, the Savior for the entire world. He speaks of a Savior that would welcome everyone into God's family, not just the Jewish people. Because verse 3, Jeremiah says, God says, I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I've driven them and will bring them back to their pasture. So the Israelites then say, okay, God's going to bring me out and take me home to Jerusalem. But for those of us today with the benefit of looking over history, we get excited because we hear Jesus echoing in our ear in John chapter 10 when Jesus said that I've got other sheep. They're not of the sheep pen. I'm going to bring them in also. They too will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Big picture. Verse 4, God talks about placing shepherds to watch over his people. And the Israelites are thinking about themselves at the time. We're reading that and we're thinking, oh my gosh, all the times Jesus talked about putting a shepherd over his people, a pastor over his people, shepherd, pastor, it's the same word. There's verses like John chapter 21, verse 16, Jesus tells Peter to tend his sheep. Watch over my people, Peter. Acts chapter 20, verse 28, Paul instructs the overseers of the church to be good shepherds of God's church. Watch over the people, pastor them well. Ephesians chapter 4 is another verse where Christ gives a charge through Paul that says that some people have been called to be pastors, shepherds, taking care of God's people. All of these are pointing back to that first part of verse 4. The second part of verse 4 from Jeremiah 23, it talks about assuring us not to fear. God says, don't fear, you're not going to be lost, none of you are going to be missing. How many times did Jesus tell us throughout the New Testament, do not be afraid? One of my favorites I just threw up there, it's John 14, verse 27. And then Jesus has words in Luke chapter 15 and John chapter 10 where there's assurance of Jesus' commitment, where he promises, look, none of you will go missing. If one wanders off, I'll go out. I'm searching. I'm coming to find you. And don't worry, no one can steal you out of my Father's hands. I've got you. I'm holding you tight. You won't be lost. You won't be stolen away. It's that assurance, that promise to all of us from verse 4 into the New Testament. Verse 5, God says he's going to raise up for David a righteous branch, a king that will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. It's the promise of the coming Messiah. It's the promise of the coming Savior of the world. But for the Jews in captivity, they're looking for an earthly king with an earthly throne. Thank God for where we are in history, because we can see that God's speaking of a coming Christ and of a kingdom that has no end. As far as David's line, the prophecy that the verse 5 talks about, it's a neat thing, not everybody realizes, but if you go through the genealogies of Jesus, Matthew chapter 1 and Luke chapter 3, if you look through and go through them carefully, one of them is telling us that Jesus traces his lineage back to David through his mother Mary's genetics. The other tells us that Jesus can trace his lineage through David by going through his adoptive father's customary heritage. Both directions, and no matter how you look at it, he still goes back to David. That's pretty cool fulfillment. And as far as the king part, John chapter 18, Jesus comes out and says to himself, to Pilate, he says, you're right, I am the king, and I've come to bring the truth. And it's that truth that we can hope and hold on to today. Verse 6, the last verse of that passage from Jeremiah that we're looking at today, says the Messiah will be the Lord, a righteous Savior. Again, small picture thinking. The Jews are looking for that immediate salvation from their captivity in Babylon. But God's a good God, and he's got bigger, better, more eternal things in mind. So there's verses like 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. He says Jesus would be righteous. Philippians chapter 2 talks about his lordship. Acts chapter 4 makes it clear that Jesus is the Savior and source of our salvation. That's a lot of scripture I just threw at you. I get it. I don't expect you to take it all in. That's why the chart's there. I encourage you to take the time this week, go back, dig in, whether it's in life group, whether you take some time for yourself. But take a moment, look those all up, because they are full of hope. That's part of the excitement of Christmas, is how big God takes this little passage and just blows it up for us today. But here's the thing. That's a small sampling. We just looked at a few of those verses out of the whole New Testament that keep pointing and predicting that Jesus would be Messiah, Savior of the world. The world, not just the Israelites, but for everyone. It doesn't matter when we're born. It doesn't matter where we're born. It doesn't matter to whom we are born. It includes you and me. The world finds salvation in Jesus. And it's really important that we understand this, that Jesus is quite literally Jesus. His very name means Savior, Rescuer, Deliverer. Because that's why Christmas matters. That's why we're ecstatic. That's why we can't contain ourselves. That's why we should be hooping and hollering. Not because of some gift under a tree, but because Jesus made all the difference. Jesus was the line by which everything changed for all eternity. Because of Jesus' life, if we claim him by faith, if we claim him as our Savior, there's no condemnation. There's no guilt. There's no shame. There's no reason to doubt. No judgment. Jesus is the hope that we hold on to. Jesus is the hope that holds us. Do you realize it changed? Instead of holding on to hope, that hope reaches out and holds us through the tough times. I said earlier that his birth was a finish line and a start line. The finish of the long wait for the Messiah, the start line for the redemption of the world. But here's the thing about a start line and a finish line. They don't mean anything until somebody crosses it. It's just paint on the ground until someone crosses. Until that first runner or the first car crosses the line, the race hasn't started. And it's not over until somebody crosses that line first. The hoopla, the excitement, the energy for Christmas, it's not about gifts from some fictitious character in a red suit. The excitement is that Jesus crossed the line from heaven to earth. The wait was over. The Savior was born. His first breath was the start of what it would take to save the world from there. No, not there. From our sins. And yeah, the wordplay is intentional. Because Jesus crossed the line at the cross. The line had been drawn in the sand. Man drew a line in the Garden of Eden, and it separated God and man because of rebellious disobedience. God saw and drew a line and said, no more broken relationship with my creation. And so God sends Jesus to make it all right from above. What started in a manger finished on a cross. Jesus was born. He endured life as we all do. He experienced the same suffering. He experienced the same temptations we all face. But he didn't give in. He didn't fall to sin. He endured so that he could take it to the cross and make a way back to the Father for all of us. What started with an everyday birth ended with a once for all eternity death so that we could have the victory. He suffered, we win. It's a great deal. No more having to yield to temptation. No more eternal separation from God in heaven. No more suffering. Because of Jesus. Because of Christmas. It starts there. Let's not kid ourselves. There's going to be tears on earth. They're going to come. They're temporary. And that's okay. But it all ends when our faith in Christ is realized. When we as believers, when the believer will pass into heaven when this ride is over, Jesus will restore us from all of life's disappointments. That's the hope Israel had coming. That's what they were promised, and they didn't even know to look for it. To those that believe on Jesus, God gives more than hope. He's given us the promise of a truth to hold on to. We're held by the realization of our hope because of God's promises to the world. they're all fulfilled through Jesus. So here's the question, Mountain View. Are you in captivity this morning? Is something holding you? Are you settling for hoping for the small temporary present? The Israelites had small hopes for immediate answers, and we get caught up in that small thinking. We hope for immediate present. I'm telling you, don't settle for the temporary under the tree. Look for the eternal that was on the tree. That's the real gift. That's the promise. That's the fulfillment for glorious eternity. And this happens in life. We see it. We see pictures of it throughout our life. I'll give you one example. You've heard us talk about Riverside, little church down in Orange. They've been hoping for life for their church again. And they had a small vision that their little church would be vibrant again. But God had more in mind. And so now, people from Riverside are holding on as their expectations. They're being exceeded, but not as they expected, and not without some pain. And it's kind of how life works for us, right? There's some pain along the way as God works bigger things. Because for Riverside, that church is going to have to die. It will die. But it will emerge again, a new creation, a branch, the first branch of Mountain View, as we reach to help free those captive by sin in Orange County, with a broader reach, more resources than anybody could have ever imagined. It's God's bigger plan. It's emerging as we come. That's the exciting part, and it's exciting we get to be a part of this. There's ways to join in your program. You can see those if you want to look later. But I'm not kidding myself either, because for some of you, this might ring a little hollow. Some of you are wrestling right now because life's full of some real struggles, and the realities feel overwhelming, and maybe that's where you're at this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9 says, "Indeed, we felt we received a sentence of death. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. He's delivered us from such deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we've set our hope that he will continue to deliver us." Hear me out. Dying and a sentence of death are two totally different things. A sentence of death would be eternal. But dying is just a stop on the journey to eternal life for the believer. Little Church Riverside is going to die to live. Jesus died so that we all might live. The sad fact of life is that we all die. But for the believers in Christ, for those who take that leap of faith and accept his promise of hope, live again. These believers live again in eternal glory. That's the hope of Christmas. That's what holds us through the tough times. We go wild celebrating that hope of eternal life, not some ribbons and bows. It's not about the wrapping paper. And don't get frustrated with me. Please don't hear it's just some random platitudes I'm talking about from up here that I know nothing about. Because no one's pain is the same. No one truly understands what anyone else is going through. But here's the thing. When I was working on this message, I'm sitting at the table the day after Thanksgiving at my 84-year-old grandmother's house, realizing that from what we're being told, there's a good chance, it's most probable, that this might be the last Thanksgiving with my mother. And so that means there's a real possibility that we're getting ready to celebrate our last Christmas with her. It's her favorite time of the year. So without faith in the promises of Jesus, there's no hope in it. Yeah. But here's the thing for my family. Here's the thing for you and your family. We are held by that hope. Our family holds it together because there is hope in Jesus. And the hope, the truth is this, that this is not her end, and it will get better for her. Just probably not here. I'm sure those at Calvary 2,000 years ago felt that way. Hope may have appeared lost for a moment on the cross. But 3 days later, when that tomb's empty, and Jesus is standing outside saying, "Why are you crying?" Hope is restored again. That's how it is with God. When things look bad in the short term, He's often working to knock them out of the park in the long term. And that's what's on the line this Christmas. Because Christmas takes our eyes off of those short-term struggles. And it picks us up and it puts our focus squarely on the long-term victory that God's given us. That victory that gives us the hope Jesus came to bring. And that's the truth. When life seems overwhelming, we need Jesus. When nothing fulfills, we need Jesus. When there's times where we can't forgive ourselves or anyone else, we need Jesus. This world needs Jesus. He's our lifeline. And I say that to say this, that Tamika came to us this week. She said, I've got a song and it might fit. Just I saw the blurb, it might fit. And I have to admit, she was right. God knew what he was doing and speaking to her anyway because it is powerful. So this is going to be a time of worship. They're coming up here on the stage. The ladies, you want to join us? They're coming up here. This is a time of prayer and worship for you. Let the words of this song soak in. Bask in the worship with them. But let God speak to your heart. Let God speak to you. What adjustment is God calling you to make this Christmas season?
Show me your face, fill up this space. My world needs you right now. My world needs you right now. I can't escape being afraid. Fill me with you. My world needs you right now.
Show me your face, fill up this space. My world needs you right now. My world needs you right now. I can't escape being afraid.
face. Come fill this space. My world needs you right now. My world needs you.
Merry Christmas. That's it. That's the gift.